Hello everyone, welcome to Dr. Romesh's Bird Sanctuary. It's a rainy day here in Brisbane, Australia, but it hasn't dissuaded my birds. In fact, they love it. And as you can see, my efforts have been rewarded with lots and lots and lots of birds. I've now got a flock, I just counted about 35-40 birds. And there are about 4 species here right now. This is right on my doorstep, as you can see. And I'll show you the birds. This is Brisbane's only bird sanctuary. And it's a very a festive atmosphere, you could say. Now those birds are rainbow lorikeets, the parrots are, and they're feeding with crested pigeons. Oh, that's one crested pigeon. And the bird at the back is a noisy miner, which is a type of honey eater. And I've now got a flock of about 15. It's a family, a single family unit. And they're absolutely delightful. That bird, the bird that's going, in fact those birds, those are blue-faced honey eaters. And they're new arrivals just in the last week or so. No, well maybe 2 weeks. And these are babies, and you can tell because they haven't got a blue face. That one has got a sort of an orange face. It's a baby. And that one over there is an adolescent. It's got a green face. And as you can see, these birds are very excited. They're excited by the rain and excited by the food. And this is the slices of bread that I'm giving them. Plain white bread from the supermarket. It's a dollar a loaf. And I'm using about 3 loaves a day now, 3 or 4 loaves. Started off with just one. But I'm attracting, as you can see, lots of birds. That little bird over there, that little wet bird with the yellow on its back, that's a scaly-breasted lorikeet. And they're part of a mixed flock. Last year, a flock of about 30 of these birds came to the garden, but just on the one occasion. These ones, there are 4 of them that I've counted so far. They've got a baby as well. It was here in the morning, and it came right up to my feet, about a foot away from my foot. And these birds are becoming tamer and tamer. And it's lovely for me. I'll thank you. So you can see that they are all eating different parts of the bread. The blue-faced honey eaters like the crusts, the parrots like the white middle of the bread, and the babies, the baby parrots, they have a tendency to go and sit right in the middle of the slice of bread and make that sound. That's the baby sound. That's the baby that's up in the tree. You can see they walk along when they're on the tree. That's the baby following. And these little noisy miners, they really like this perch that I've made for them. And just watching them interact, I'm learning a lot about birds, which I failed to learn when I was a child, and I was painting birds, but I was shooting them first. Sometimes I'd observe them with my binoculars, but if it was a new species, I'd try and shoot it with my air gun. Therefore, birds were sensible enough not to come to my garden. And as soon as it's gone, its place taken by another one. Now these honey eaters, these black-headed honey eaters, or noisy miners as they're called, Mandarina melanocephala, they are closely related, and you can see that from their behavior. They're both omnivorous, with a lot of insects in their diet, and they have similar juvenile or chick calls, very similar, and they also play together. One of the things that these birds do is they do little communication tricks with their beaks, especially the noisy miners. They do that sound to me sometimes, and I'm lucky. And these ones have this sound. Now that's another sound that the noisy miners make. That sound. Now I've identified about 10 very distinct. Now that's not an alarm call. That's just a different sound. The alarm call goes geek 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 like that. And then they've also got a very lovely little purry sort of a sound.
like that. And that's the sound that they make when they're being friendly and have some food to give to the baby. These. These birds are absolute treasures. And in the last month, it suddenly started happening. I've got these birds in my garden, in this front tree, all day, from dawn till dusk. Dusk, they all go and roost somewhere else. They go back home. And the whole day, I've got birds, so I think I can rightfully call it a bird sanctuary. I've got a lot of baby birds. Even got a little baby scrub turkey. I haven't filmed it. I haven't had a chance to film it, but I took some photographs of it. And it is ever so cute. It's a little scrub turkey. About that size. Let me get my hand there. About that size. And it looks furry. It looks like a mammal. It looks like a little rodent, or and it behaves like a rodent as well. It runs around in there and in here. And these birds, these scrub turkeys, are so like little dinosaurs, but they're also like mammals, and they behave like mammals. And they're not turkeys. They're not related to turkeys. Not the turkeys that they eat at Thanksgiving. But they did. They look superficially a bit like ones. So they used to be shot, and they still are. And Aboriginal people eat these turkeys. But when I discovered the extraordinary nesting and behavior of scrub turkeys, I wouldn't eat them. Because they're really like little dinosaurs. But also they build these communal nests, mounds, about maybe 2 meters or 3 meters in diameter. And these can have up to 30 eggs, and the males carefully build these nests. And regulate the temperature of the eggs inside, where the females lay the eggs, obviously. They regulate the temperature by sticking their red heads. They're naked, they've got no feathers on their head. They stick their head inside the mound. And by doing that, they can regulate whether they're male or female chicks. Now, I didn't know any of this. And you can find all this information out by the Wikipedia. And I'm a big fan of Wikipedia. And one of the things that I'm doing with my Holistic University Network is trying to integrate my research with Wikipedia, because it's unprecedented for human beings to have this kind of access to knowledge. And the fact that people know all these details about scrub turkeys is a reflection of how much zoology and ornithology has changed since the time of the European colonists, who were basically harvesting birds and shooting them and shipping them back to Europe to stuff and put in their collections. Now, that's the style of ornithology that I grew up with, and the style of
the Charles Darwin and Alfred Russel Wallace and all these icons of biology. And this is the book that I studied birds from when I was in Sri Lanka when I was a child. It belongs to my mother. Well, it belongs to my mother. She gave it to me. And it's written by G.M. Henry. Now you can see that beautiful line drawings. And that's from the Oxford University Press, 1971. Now, this book shows some of the Sri Lankan parrots. And these are absolutely beautiful bird paintings. And this is the book that I learned to paint birds from. If you compare these beautiful drawings where you can see the bird in its natural postures, and these are not done from photographs, these are done from somebody observing birds carefully, like I did with the binoculars. And you compare that with Slater, Field Guide to Australian Birds. And you can see that these are all about bird identification, where the birds have, they look like they're dead. They look like birds that have been shot and then drawn. So this person's obviously this is a shooting book, and I know that because I've got a friend who went to university with me, who has one of these books so that he can identify them and shoot them. And there are also likewise these other books that are designed for shooting, identification and shooting. This book is a new one, and it's got, again, like the G.M. Henry's book from Sri Lanka, excuse me, it's got very, very realistic, it's got very realistic paintings. Some of the colors are not quite right, but this is a very beautiful book, and it shows the distribution of these different birds. Now these are the rainbow lorikeets, this one here. And this is its distribution. Now, if you look at what they say about it, they say sociable, noisy, acrobatic, right? And the voice, strong, screet, noisy, chattering. All right, well, that's not exactly a detailed observation or an accurate observation of the extraordinary complexity of rainbow lorikeet language. And you'll find the same thing with the description of the noisy miner. Now that's a noisy miner's alarm call. That's a blue-faced honeyeater, but I can't see it. Now, you heard that? That was a blue-faced honey eater, and the noisy miner is answering it. Oh, there you see it is. You see, they get on very well. And I've noticed them making these interspecies friendships and playing. Birds play a lot. But they say parrots are sociable. They don't really acknowledge that they play. And I've seen baby rainbow lorikeets tussling with each other like puppies or kittens do, like mammals do. And they cuddle up to each other and they're very, very affectionate to each other. So let's see what they say about the noisy miner. It'll be under honey eaters. These are all, they call them all honey eaters, but they're not actually, they don't feed on honey much, I don't think. They probably will eat honey if you give them honey, but that's not what they eat most of the time. They eat insects. Now that's a noisy miner. That's see the green on its wing there, and the yellow naked patch around its eye. Now, this picture doesn't quite show the face correctly, and this one, what they're calling a yellow-throated miner, you can see there's very little yellow in the throat. And there's a lot of variation between these, and I'd say that these are all actually one species. They've just been given different names, and that's supported by the distribution of the quality. Yellow-throated miner is all of Australia except for the east coast where you've got the noisy miner. So there's a little bit of an overlap there. But it's quite obviously the same species, and in the central parts of Australia, where it is more yellow in colour, the environment, they have a little bit of yellow on the underside of their neck. So let's see what they call this. Noisy miner, colonial aggressive, black mask from crown to chin, rest of head grey, bill, bare skin behind eye, feet yellow, back rump grey, underparts pale grey. It's sort of silly to be repeating all of these things because you can see them from the photograph, and they don't provide any real information about these. Juvenile less distinctly marked. So again, this book is really for shooters. Voice: a garrulous honey eater. Harsh calls, wee, wee, wee. That's actually their alarm call. Habitat: open woodland, dominates cleared remnants and gardens. Now, these birds are not dominating. In fact, they make way for the parrots. And even the little scaly-breasted lorikeets are given way to by these noisy miners. So you can say that, like they demonize various political enemies of the white men, they also demonize the avian enemies. They're not even enemies. They just get alarmed when people are going near their homes with guns and sticks and weapons.
And they never do alarm calls at me because they're not alarmed by me. So for those who think that noisy miners are pests, I'll just point out that they were here long before we were. So anyway, that's Dr. Romesh's bird sanctuary on a rainy day, rainy summer's day in Brisbane. And thanks for watching my YouTube.